Hello, everyone. Right, so just to get started, so you know who I am and why I'm standing here. I work on both PostgreSQL and for Enterprise DB. I've been the pgAdmin project lead for about 19 years now, since the project started. Also work on the core team of PostgreSQL, the web and sysadmin teams, and a couple of our non-profit organizations. And at EDB, for my day job, my official title is Vice President, Chief Architect, Tools and Installers. What that basically means is I answer questions about code most of the day and commit stuff, and occasionally make a cup of coffee. So that's me. pgAdmin 3, who's used that before? Yeah, pretty much everyone in the room, apart from the sound guy. So what is it? What was wrong with it? How do we fix it? Well, for many years, it was the leading open source GUI management tool for PostgreSQL. We had millions of downloads a year. It was the third generation, hence the 3. Replaced earlier tools that were written in Visual Basic, pgAdmin 1 in 1998, which was really my first attempt at any real programming. Then pgAdmin 2, which was me correcting all the mistakes I made in pgAdmin 1. We wrote pgAdmin 3 in C++. Couple of reasons for that. We wanted to make it cross-platform. We wanted to be able to handle Unicode, multi-byte character sets, and so on, which is pretty much impossible in VB5 and 6. And you can download pgAdmin 3 standalone or with the one-click PostgreSQL installers from EDB. We supported a number of Postgres databases. Unlike most of the other community projects, we're actually quite friendly towards the commercial derivatives, and had first-class support for EDB's Postgres Plus Advanced Server and Greenplum's database, which is now from Pivotal. So I guess everybody's seen a screenshot like that before. For those that haven't, that's what pgAdmin 3 looks like. Kind of dated, which is really the first thing that's wrong with it. It is very dated. It's C++ code that goes back to about 2002. Grown quite messy over time. One thing that you might not realize is actually really hard to find C++ developers in the Postgres community. So it was largely maintained by, for many years, just by a small group of 4 or 5 people, of which at any one time probably only 2 or 3 at most are active. The look and feel is kind of dated. WX widgets hasn't really changed in many, many years. And we kind of inherit the look from that. And these days, there's a lot more people are working on the web, of course. You've got cloud installations of databases. You're not necessarily doing everything on a desktop and talking to a big box in the server room behind you. You might have many people that are working on a cluster of servers that are actually out in Amazon or Azure or somewhere like that. We also had problems with the dependencies on some of the third-party libraries, in particular WX widgets, which of course we were completely dependent on. As some examples there of some bugs that got reported regularly to us. There was very little we could do about them because they were in the underlying WX widgets code. I could have patched it for some builds that I do myself, but if you're running on a build, for example, on Fedora, you're dependent on the WX widgets libraries that ship with Fedora. So there's no way for me to get patches into there unless the WX widgets team actually accept them upstream, which never seems to happen. So that got to the point where it caused us so many problems, we were tearing our hair out and not just losing it through old age. So we thought about how do we fix this? And eventually decided, well, we've really got no choice but to change the whole technology stack. That'll make it easier to find developers if we choose something that's more relevant and more widely used in the Postgres community. We can make it web-based to satisfy those users that are running out in the cloud and in other environments other than their desktops. We can make it easier to change the look and feel. HTML, CSS, we can restyle it, change colors, change the border radiuses on things, move things around really easily compared to WX widgets, where we would end up editing XML files that defined the layout of the form, but didn't give us the flexibility to change the look and feel of individual controls, for example. We could also get rid of the very complex and buggy underlying libraries, which would cause us so many problems. The downside of that, of course, is it means a complete rewrite, which, as you can imagine, after 15 years of development, is a fairly large amount of work. So we came up with a plan for pgAdmin4. We had some basic expectations. We want to be able to run in both web and in desktop modes. So we want to be able to support the users that are developing code on their laptops and just want to sit on a plane or on the train or at home, hack on their databases while they're developing their applications, just locally on their machines. But we also wanted to support the web use case, the cloud use case. Obviously, we needed a technology stack that was familiar to developers and contributors in the Postgres community, because that's where we're most likely to get additional contributions from. We know the basic functionality of pgAdmin was what people wanted. You know, it was the most popular management tool, and that spoke well that we were, you know, had the features that people needed. Maybe not designed in the ideal way, but the basic functionality was pretty much right. We did know that there were some features in pgAdmin 3 that people just didn't use. I mean, I'm guessing nobody in this room has ever used pgAdmin to create an operator family. I'm looking for hands, but I'm not expecting to see any.
I've done it in pgdom, or the test pgdom.
In pgdom, no, you use pgsql, I know you. Yeah. So there are a bunch of features like that that we knew people just were never, ever going to use. And there seemed little point in spending the time and effort to rewrite them. So we settled on eventually using Python for the back end. It's a very mature language. It's been around since the early 90s. It's used extensively in the PostgreSQL.org infrastructure. So whenever you're on any of the Postgres websites that we've developed as part of the project, you're probably looking at a Django-based website. The deployment and management platform that the sysadmin team use for all the servers underneath is written almost exclusively in Python. And it works very well with Postgres. There's a good choice of drivers out there. PsychoPG2, which we ended up using, is very solid, very reliable, and has a very responsive lead developer who's always open to helping us out with problems. On the front end, we went for JavaScript, jQuery, and Bootstrap. They're fairly common technologies. Lots of people know them. They're tried and tested. Loads of developers out there. And to pin it all together on the Python end, we used the Flask micro framework, which is, it's sort of like Django, but it's much more lightweight. And where Django is designed for building data-driven applications, Flask is more focused on just building the core of an application. Now, we obviously had a number of both non-functional requirements and functional requirements that we wanted to meet. We wanted pgAdmin to be a framework, primarily, so that it can be easily extended. So if the PostGIS guys want to add a shape loader or something like that, they can very easily do that. They've got the APIs there. They can write a module, drop it into an instance of pgAdmin, and away you go. So what we've ended up with is all the individual tree view nodes are plugins. Use case for those is the extensions to support Greenplum and Advanced Server, both of which have object types that are not in PostgreSQL. The individual tools are plugins. So things like the query tool, the grant wizard, and so on are using a plugin API that lets you just add more tools, hook them into the menus, get access to the database connections very easily. And the database drivers themselves are also plugins, so that we can extend the driver to include Greenplum-specific functionality or advanced server functionality or whatever comes next year. We wanted it to be deployable on the desktop, as we said, and on a web server for multiple users. That's a key point. When you're running on a web server, you don't fire up an application on the web and just start using it like you do on your desktop. It's open to the world, probably, so you're going to need authentication, user accounts, and things like that that we never had to deal with before. Packaging-wise, we wanted Windows and Mac packages. We wanted Linux RPMs and Debian packages, and a Python wheel for deployment using pip. And we need to support all versions of Python that are commonly found on operating systems used by our users. Unfortunately, that's quite a wide range. So if we look back at RHEL 6, for example, CentOS 6, it's still using Python 2.6. And yet other more modern operating systems, like the up-to-date Fedoras, are using the later 3 series of Python. So we had quite a lot of compatibility issues there to deal with. We also needed to make sure that we could support one or more servers simultaneously. That was a key feature of pgAdmin 3. pgAdmin 2 and below really could only connect to one server at a time. We wanted to support all Postgres data types, as well as ones you can plug in and add to the system. Full support for Unicode. So if you're working in Hebrew or Chinese or Japanese or Russian, we don't want you to have any problems. We want it to work perfectly for you as well. And we want to support localization, internationalization, so you can, it feels familiar. It's in your home language. You eventually will have support for displaying numbers and things with dots or commas as appropriate to your particular locale. We don't have all of that just yet, unfortunately, but we're getting there. Obviously, we want it to be speedy, fast response, so it feels like a desktop application. We don't want it to feel like a website when it's running on your desktop. And key to that is having no full page reloads. So everything we do is AJAX based. So if any of you have ever used the old PHP pgAdmin application that was released years and years ago, pretty much every time you did anything in that, it would reload the whole page and show you the new view. We didn't want any of that. We want it to look and feel like it's running on the desktop, even though it's in your browser. And a number of functional requirements. Support for all the common database object types. So this is the bit where we dropped Stephen's operator families. Sorry, dude. Query tool. pgAdmin 3 had two separate tools, a query tool and the view data tool. You could run queries in the query tool and see the results. You could view the contents of tables in the view data tool and edit those query results directly in the grid. Essentially, though, they're basically one tool, so we wanted to merge them together and over time add more and more smarts to it so that we get to the point where you can run an arbitrary query and it will figure out on the fly if you can update the results or not. Not quite there yet. We're adding more and more smarts, but we have done it as one tool to begin with that just runs in two modes at the moment. We wanted some dashboards for simple real-time monitoring, something pgAdmin 3 never had. Procedural language debugger, which a lot of people find very useful. Grant wizard for managing the access control lists on your objects, and the ability to run things like backup and restore. The ability to do maintenance operations, run vacuum, analyze, and so on. As well as various small utilities, being able to pause and resume while replay or add named restore points. Allowing users to understand what they're doing is critical, so we've got online help for the actual use of the application and describing what the different dialogues do and how to use each of the buttons and so on. But what we also have is links to the documentation for either PostgreSQL or Advanced Server as appropriate. So when you're editing a table, you can press a button and go straight to the Create Table SQL syntax documentation to help you understand not just how the application is working through the application documentation, but also what the underlying SQL is doing. We also needed a user manager with self-service password management and so on, so that when you're in multi-user mode, you can log in and the system is secure. So, how do we build all of this? So, for the first year or so, I was just developing code and sort of prototyping and building the core infrastructure. And then at that point, once I'd got it the way I wanted it, I was able to use a bunch of staff at EDB. And that really helped because I was able to boss them around, basically. One of the problems you often have with open source projects is people don't tend to work for you. They're all volunteers. So actually having a well-defined project that you're trying to get X, Y, and Z done in a very short time frame, unless you've got very cooperative volunteers, is very hard to do. So it made it much easier because I was able to use some of the staff at work to do much of this work for us. We had a fairly large team, so the guys worked on this for about a year, probably about 9 months until we got the first release out. Three developers and committers who'd worked on pgAdmin for a long time. That's myself, Shesh Vashi, and Akshay Joshi. And then there were six other developers, a designer, project manager, four QA people, two technical writers, the lead one of which wrote the basically the first ever PostgreSQL book that was released. Three guys working on the packaging. And then in the community, we've had something like 40 individual contributors, just with anything from typo fixes to more complex changes. And that was our first sign that this was a good move, because all of a sudden we've gone from a C++ app that rarely had anyone writing any fixes to the first version of an application having nearly 40 people actually helping us get it right that were outside of the core development team. We had about 75 people as well reporting bugs, which bugs are inevitable. We want to know where they are and how to trigger them. We had a couple of constraints that we had to work within. The team that were doing the work mostly were the Postgres Enterprise Manager team at EDB. That's our enterprise management tool. So they needed to start work after PEM 6 was released, finish in time for the PEM 7 work that they're currently doing right now. Also needed to allow time for any updates that we had to do in the meantime, and also allow time for any support escalations within the company. We also needed to make sure that the code was ready to go out in the Postgres 9.6 installers, because we'd always release new versions of pgAdmin with the new version of Postgres. So it was a fairly heavy set of constraints to try and meet. And as such, it took a fair amount of management to figure out how we could get everything done in that time frame. We used fairly traditional methods. We weren't using a full agile method or anything like that, because it makes it very difficult to predict where you're going to be in a year's time when you're using agile methodologies. So we were using a product called Project Manager, where we, as you would expect, estimated each individual task, figured out what they all were, assigned them to people, sequenced it all up, and so on. When we came to patch management, that also proved to be difficult, because at the beginning I was the only one dealing with patches, and I might get 20, 30 patches a week, which is a fairly significant amount for one person to deal with. So we ended up using a Kanban chart to actually manage the patches through the various stages of review, back to developer, in review again, and then committed, and so on. Then once we actually released, we moved everything across to the community's Redmine installation, which is where we have things like the bug trackers now. That was a quick screenshot of the project management plan. I think there was, if I remember rightly, there was something like 400 tasks on there for the whole project, just to build the basic features that we needed, and it spanned about 9 months. So as you can imagine, that was a pretty complex plan to manage. And there's the just a screenshot of the Kanban chart that was used for the patch review. So we've got the in development column, review, committed, bugs transferred to Redmine. And I think there were a couple of others that you can't see on there now. But we've basically stopped using this now that we've got the first version out the door. One of the key things in getting a project out so quickly is that we have good quality assurance. You know, we don't want to just write code and throw it out the door. And there were various things we tried to try and make it as high quality code as possible. So I managed to steal some of the QA team at EDB and engage them in testing as we went through. They developed manual test cases based on the code that was being committed and the individual tasks that were being done, and used the system that they use generally called Test Rail, which allows them to track test runs and passes and failures and so on. One of their guys also built our first automated test framework, which was built on Python 2's unit test module. That allows us to do testing of the REST APIs that the Python code provides for the front end code. And we've also added automated testing. And I've given this talk before, and in previous slides it used to say coming soon now, or something like that. But as of this morning, it now says framework developed post 1.2 by Pivotal Labs, who I'll talk more about later on. But that's integrated into the Python test framework and uses Selenium so that we can run tests that literally go right from the browser through to the back end. We also had quite a bit of community testing. The problem with that is it tends to be very ad hoc. You know, there's no people playing with the code in the community literally will just download it and play with it. They're not going to go through any test plans. They're not going to go through any rigorous process to make sure there's good coverage of everything and so on. So whilst it's greatly appreciated and essential, we can't rely on that sort of testing alone. We did get a lot of very good feedback from the testers. We did get some negative feedback as well. We'll talk about some of that in a little bit. But you always get negative feedback, so we carry on regardless, and we take on board what we're told. And there's just a quick screenshot of the regression tests, which just run automatically, one after the other across multiple databases, depending on how you've got the system configured. So, to give you an idea of the release timeline, the first time I gave this talk, there was about two lines on this slide. This is probably the last time I'm going to give this talk, as it is now. I think I've done it three times around the world now, and this slide's got a little bit bigger each time. We've just released 1.3 on the 10th of March, about 3 weeks ago. As you can see, we're actively fixing bugs in each new version and adding new features, which is something we never did in pgAdmin 3. We were very strict about never adding new features. Because pgAdmin 4 is so new, and because a lot of users are used to all the features in pgAdmin 3, what we found is some of the ones that we thought we didn't need, we actually do. So we're being a bit more relaxed about adding new things now. And again, we'll talk about this more on one of the later slides. That was a little screenshot I took on Sunday. I know it says as of 10th of March, but I guess that's the last time OpenHub scanned the repo. So you can see the activity throughout 2016 just basically shot up, and the size of the code base increased drastically as the project progressed. The OpenHub site, I haven't included a screenshot of it, but OpenHub actually reckoned the project is worth about $3.5 million at this point, based on Kokomo estimates. The reality is there's some libraries in the source tree which are not ours. If you take those out, it's probably down to about $2 million. But it's a pretty large number. I was very surprised when I saw that. I know we put in a lot of effort, but it's still surprising a number. To give you an idea of how much code there is now, one of our audience members and I were just talking about the ratio of Python to JavaScript in the code base earlier. I originally thought it was going to be largely Python, probably, 75% Python and 25% JavaScript. It's turned out, and as I was rightly corrected earlier, it's such a UI and front-end heavy app that it's no real surprise when you think about it that actually most of the code is JavaScript. So that's 152,000 lines. And when I took that, I did try and exclude all the libraries that were not ours, that we were just using. So about 44,000 lines of Python. You add all of that up, and over 250,000 lines of code. Now, obviously, we should all get paid by lines of code we write, right? So I reckon I'm due a pretty big bonus. So post-release, and anyone who's seen this talk before, you won't have seen this bit because this is the bit I wrote at the weekend while I was sat in my hotel room all day. The team's expanded a lot. The pivotal labs have started working on pgAdmin now because they want to add GreenPlum support. And they also want to contribute to further enhancements and improving various features of the application. They're not just providing development expertise, but they've got project managers looking at user stories, understanding what the users want by interviewing them and talking to them, doing workshops and similar things, and then designing features based on that feedback. We're hoping to do more and more of that as we move forward, so that when we improve pgAdmin, it's not based on what we think people want anymore, but it starts to become more and more based on what the users tell us they want. Aside from that, I mean, it's great having the Pivotal guys on board because they've really diversified the experience in the pgAdmin team, most of whom have come from pgAdmin 3 originally and have been learning new technologies. The Pivotal team have a lot more experience than we do on the web code, and have been able to bring some really good new ideas to the table. They've also provided additional test suites, the Selenium-based one that I mentioned earlier, and another test suite based on Jasmine for unit testing the JavaScript code, and obviously are working on features, fixes, and helping us work with more of a formal design process. We obviously had to run the original project in a fairly formal way, otherwise we wouldn't have been successful. But moving forward, we're trying to improve now. In pgAdmin 3, we would just design features based on what we want, and as I said, we have the benefit of people now looking and really trying to understand what users need. We're also syncing up between the teams regularly, which is good. So it's not just a collaboration on the mailing list, but we're also talking to each other and really planning in depth where we're going, which is great. This is a little screenshot of some of the work that has been done. What we found is users want various things out of the history and the query tool, and this apparently is proving to be pretty popular, pretty popular feature request. So what we have here is basically a mock-up of the new history that would eventually be persistent. So instead of just being for that session you're currently running, you could go back and look at the queries you ran last Tuesday, for example. You can see very clearly the error messages that came, any notices at the bottom that came when you ran it, as well as the full query text, which you can just copy and paste back in and run again if you want to. So there's one example of the great work that the guys at Pivotal have been contributing. Not sure what release this is going to be in just yet. It's still being fine-tuned and worked on. But I'm hoping to see it in the next couple of months. I'm looking for nods from the back corner of the room.
We are hoping for a couple of weeks.
Couple of weeks. Ooh, God. Next couple of weeks, please, guys. So some of the things we've learned, bugs are inevitable. We have professional QA people that have been helping us with pgAdmin. But no matter what you do, how much you test, there will always be bugs in horrendously complex bits of software like this. You know, we've got hundreds of features. If you count up every little last thing you can do, every bit of SQL that you can generate through the UI and so on. Thousands of options if you think you can, all the different data types you could create on columns and whether or not they're primary keys or whether or not they're unique and all the constraints you can put on them. Supporting 6 versions of Python, 10 supported databases, 11 when the Greenplum compatibility work is finished, and 5 core browsers, each of which have lots of different versions out there and some of which evolve very, very rapidly. So you can imagine there are millions of combinations of things you can do and run pgAdmin in. So there's no way you're going to do a fully comprehensive manual test of all those possible combinations of options and software versions and so on. And there's no way you're going to do it in an automated fashion either. But we need to do whatever we can to try and minimize those bugs, of course, regardless. So, testing. pgAdmin 3 never had any test suites at all. It was released every time with us just clicking through, trying it. Can I connect to a database? Yep. Can I run a SQL query? Yep. Can I open the help file? Yep. Done. Release it. You know, it literally was sort of Saturday afternoon hobby hacking. I mean, that's how the project started. Nowadays, we've got the 3 automated test suites. They are being run for every check-in. There's a Jenkins server that I'm running that is building everything it can possibly build, running all of the automated tests against every supported database on every single version of Python. And we're continuing to add to that suite. As and when we find bugs, we're going to be enhancing the suite to make sure those bugs don't come back. As and when we build new features, we'll be enhancing the suite to make sure that those features work as they're supposed to. So we're never going to get it perfect. But we're really concentrating on testing these days and making sure that everything we write is going to be testable moving forwards. We found there were performance issues. Shock, horror. Who'd have thought something might be slow on a computer these days? So pgAdmin 4 in a desktop app is always going to be slower than a native application, right? It's a web app. It's running in a Python interpreter and it's being rendered on what basically is a web browser. With the best will in the world, it's never going to be as fast as a native C++ app. But we never really expected it to be a problem, practically speaking. And in most cases, it actually isn't. What we found, though, users are actually very sensitive to delays that they perceive when they're running the application. If the query tool takes a second to load, practically speaking, it doesn't stop you doing anything. It's not going to slow you down because that second is when you're figuring out where to put the mouse next and what you're going to type, right? The reality is that the perception of slowness is something that tends to annoy users regardless. So we're doing a lot of work at the moment to try and address that and make everything as optimized and as fast as possible. Interestingly, I've never heard anyone complain when they are intentionally running in web mode. I think it's because people expect websites to be slow and expect things running in their web browser to be slow. Yes?
Why do you even have the desktop mode and any system that has a browser?
We have the desktop mode primarily because we don't expect everybody to be running a web server. If you're running a Windows machine, you don't want to have pgAdmin running as a server behind a web server all day long and every day. So we wanted it to be a designed such that you could just open it like a regular application, run it, close it, and it stops again. So the desktop runtime that does that for us is basically some C++ code that glues together a browser engine and a Python interpreter into one app. So it starts up, it loads the Python code, and then it renders it. So one of the changes that we have made to improve the speed already is we've rewritten the query tool and the way the results are handled and the data is transferred back to the query tool for rendering in the grid. We basically redesigned the JSON data structure that's used behind it and have, in some cases, reduced the amount of data that's transferred by up to 70%. And that actually had a fairly noticeable performance improvement with it. We've also got various ideas that we're playing with at the moment, and I think Pivotal are doing some work on this right now to optimize the JavaScript, CSS, and HTML so that we can minimize the data transfer size for that and the number of round trips and the amount of template rendering that we do and so on. Now, we spoke about the desktop runtime. We've had a number of problems with that as well, which we've primarily found when it's been in the hands of users. We found that it tends to work well for most people, but we have there are a number of situations where it just doesn't seem to work so well. We found, first of all, that embedding browsers in applications is actually hard to do and to get right. We've also found that Qt WebKit has got rendering bugs. We used Qt WebKit in the first two versions of pgAdmin 4. It has now since been deprecated in Qt 5.5 in favor of Qt Web Engine, which is based on Chromium. However, that can be significantly slower for some users and makes them complain. It can also have some fairly nasty rendering issues over RDP connections. That's the Microsoft Remote Desktop Protocol. We think it's to do with the graphics cards on the server it's running on, but some users report seeing a black screen when they load the application. There are other reports of people also using Qt Web Engine for other applications that have seen the same issues. We also run into problems with the Visual Studio runtimes. Newer versions of Qt Web Engine are dependent on Visual C 2015, which is because Chromium, the underlying browser on which it's based, has moved to that as its minimum browser, because I think they use some of the C++ 2011 spec code these days, or functionality. However, that's incompatible with the EDB Postgres packages, which use Visual C 2013, as does Python 2.7, which we use underneath. Now, for those of you that are not familiar with C and C++, you basically don't want to mix runtime versions in a single application, because if any pointers or data structures get passed between the two, seriously bad things can happen. So that causes us pain. You know, we can make things work, but the whole ecosystem of other things that we rely on suddenly becomes this incompatible mess and makes it very difficult. Solving that problem, we've looked at some other options. Chrome embedded framework, although that also requires Visual C 2015, but it does potentially solve some of the speed and rendering issues. We looked at whether or not we can securely launch an existing browser. So when you start the app, it's basically just the Python interpreter that then runs your existing browser on the system. The problem with that is we need to pass a security key to the browser so that only you can connect to the server that's running. If you're on a multi-user system, you don't want somebody else pointing their browser at your pgAdmin server. The difficulty there is the only way to pass that key is on the URL that you pass to the browser. And that means it's going through the command line, which on Windows is not a problem, but on Linux system, anyone who can ps-ef then gets to see that URL with the security key in it. So that's a fun problem. I also found, though, on Sunday when I was sitting in my hotel room being boring, that a bunch of guys have actually started a project called Qt WebKit Reloaded. They've also run into the Qt Web Engine issues that we've run into. So they've taken the old Qt WebKit code, they've brought it up to date with the latest versions of WebKit, and made it a lot more stable, fixed a number of bugs, and so on. I tried it on my Mac, and it actually seems to work really well. So as soon as I get home, I'm hoping I can get it to work on Windows as well, and maybe that will solve our problems. We also found Unicode support is really hard in Python. Because we're supporting both Python 2.6 and 3.3 and above, we have to deal with the different ways that Unicode is supported in those two versions of Python. Python 2 doesn't use Unicode by default, although it can do. Python 3 does use Unicode by default. So you'd think with a few if statements here and there you could deal with that. Unfortunately, it's not quite that simple, because it never is. What we found was that Python 2 uses the ANSI API calls on Windows. So when you're executing external processes like pgdump and pgrestore through Python, you can't pass Unicode characters to those utilities. So you can't pgdump a database with a Chinese name, for example, because Python is using the ANSI version of the API instead of the wide character version. So that's a difficult problem as well. We're probably going to have to figure out how we can build the packages for Windows using Python 3 and deprecate Python 2 on that platform. Postgres also supports lots of other character sets, and they're not all 100% compatible with Unicode, which, well, specifically UTF-8, which also potentially causes us some much more limited problems, but still ones that we need to solve. We also found that some users missed features. You know, we dropped various features that we thought people didn't use. You know, we had a fairly limited audience that we were able to actually poll when we were figuring out what to include and what not to include. And inevitably, when you've suddenly got 200,000 people downloading version 1, that application is a much bigger audience than you polled when you asked what you could get rid of. So SSL certificate-based authentication, for example, we've had a number of people ask for that back. The host address option, one of Stephen's old colleagues asked me for that, Blake. because they use it in a Kerberos environment for doing their authentication. That's just one field on the connection dialog. SSH tunneling, which never even worked that well in pgAdmin 3, because it was another one of these buggy underlying libraries. Yet I've had a bunch of people ask for it back again. And other things, like we had a database restriction field where you could put basically part of a SQL WHERE clause in your configuration, so it would only show you databases that matched that that restriction that you put in. The idea being that if you're in, a school and there's a database for every student, each student could just put effectively WHERE database name equals my database. So it hides the other 60 from them. And the scratch pad, very simple. It's just a text area on the screen that was designed for you just to use for copying and pasting things into or writing notes in and things like that. I've had a few people ask for that back. I just use my editor, but people like it in the application. So that's about where we are now. That's hopefully give you an idea of some of the things we're looking at, where we're going to at the moment. We're continuing to fix bugs, add new features, make the code more efficient, more solid, and just basically make it better. And you know, hopefully it will still be around in another 15 years like pgAdmin 3 was. And I do hope that we don't have to rewrite it before I get to retire, which would be nice. So I did have a slide here that said demo. I pulled that out when I rewrote the end because it made the talk quite a bit longer. I believe I've got about 5 minutes left. And it did. Then I realized afterwards it said in the description of this talk on the conference website that it includes a demo of the product. I can answer some questions for 5 minutes, or I can shut up and go away and catch my plane if you prefer, or we can have a very quick look at the application if you want. Any preference?
One question, whatever happens.
Okay.
Okay. Just real quickly about the installer. I like to keep my my base system pretty clean. I try to virtualize everything I can. From the standpoint of the installer,
at least on OS X, is it pretty nicely, is it fairly discrete? Like, it just installs every, like, it's an application that installs in one place.
Oh, yeah.
Do I have to install Python and this stuff?
No. On OS X, it's an app bundle in a disk image, so you drag it and drop it into your applications folder, and away you go. It's completely self-contained. Well, on Mac, it will use the system Python. It ships with a virtual environment of its own that's pre-configured, but it will use the system Python interpreter. On Windows, again, it is self-contained. On Windows, it is an installer. It will install into program files or wherever you direct it to. The big difference there is that it does include a Python executable and libraries as well, because Windows doesn't have Python by default.
So it's pretty clean.
Yeah, the RPM packages will just dump things in the relevant Python directories. They tend to be a bit more spread out. But yes?
What are the new features in 4 over 3?
Right now, the main new feature is just the dashboard. So when you... if I can get this to come out. So when you log in, for example, you get the welcome dashboard, which is designed to help guide you on what to do next. You've got quick links to configure or add a server and so on. And if you click on a database or a database server, I actually have my rendering cycle turned right down, so the graphs are taking a little while to render. But it gives you a quick view of monitoring what the system is doing. I think I've got these sampling every 10 seconds, but the default is every 1 second. Aside from that and the ability to run multi-user on the web, we haven't really added any new features yet. What we've done is redesigned various things to make them easier. So for example, when you create a table in pgAdmin 3, you'd open the Create Table dialog, then you'd go to the Columns tab, and then you'd click a button to add a column, and it'd pop up another dialog. And you'd fill that in and hit OK, and then lather, rinse, repeat. So we've done a lot of optimizations in usability where we've redesigned those sort of patterns such that you can just type straight into a grid if you want, or you can expand a row in a grid. So primarily the focus has been on avoiding the need to have lots of pop-up dialogues and so on, and make it much faster to define the table as you want. Moving forward is when, really from here on, is when we start to think about new features, starting primarily with the work Pivotal has begun. Yes? Yeah, so if you think back to 2002 when Postgres 7.3 was the current version, something like that, we didn't have roles at all. We had users and groups. And then when we added support for roles, what we did in pgAdmin 3 was users, to try and avoid confusing users too much, we called them group roles and login roles. To try and sort of keep that same sort of design. One of the choices we made in pgAdmin 4 was we're going to just treat them as roles because that's what they are in the database now. You'll notice that basically if the can login flag is set, you'll get the little icon that just looks like one person, and if the can login flag is not set, then you get the multi-person icon. So that's how you can tell at a glance whether it's a group role or a login role. Plus, of course, you can look at the properties.
We have some sort of framework for people to provide their own extensions?
So as I mentioned, the UI is pluggable. So each one of these nodes is just basically a drop-in Python package that's discovered automatically at load time and includes various bits of CSS and JavaScript and HTML that it needs to render its dialogues and so on. They're pretty easy to build, so you can just take one of those nodes and copy and paste it and edit it as you need to. And also tools like the, it needs to be in a database, I think. Tools like the, tools like the Grant Wizard are also plugins that just hook into the menu and are auto-discovered at launch time. There's documentation in the online docs about the APIs, although it's not overly extensive at the moment. I'm told I've got to stop, so I think we managed to get something vaguely approaching a demo in there, as well as some questions. So thank you very much for listening. Please download.